따와들이여 모여라.
So understanding that nature is inherently devoid of needing to accept and reject. So first we understand that, and then may there be no deviations and mistakes concerning this key point on the path. So when we then practice on the path, understanding this, understanding the primordial liberation of acceptance and rejection is to understand the nature of emptiness. So while we practice on the path to avoid those deviations, we need to practice love and compassion. And if we don't know that crucial point, then even if we cultivate some love and compassion, often it becomes like ordinary, like kind of unrecognized or unrestrained compassion. Basically, it is a compassion that where we see suffering, we feel compassion, but we also believe in the reality of what we perceive as suffering. And there are some religions, for example, who do actually develop great love and compassion for others' suffering. But often that is not then joined with an understanding of emptiness. And often they also debate a bit and try to refute the Buddhist view. And one example is that when a person falls into water, then they kind of say that Buddhists say, that when a person falls into water, then if you should think about whether or not to get them out, because if you can't get them out, then you'll die together. So you might not be able to save them. Saying that, maybe they imply that in Buddhism there is not, we don't practice as much compassion as they do. And to some extent, even though there is great compassion in Buddhism, part of it is true. We really have to see, can we really protect that person? And often there's nothing that we can also do to protect that person. And so then if I know that I cannot protect that person, and if I jump into the water, then what is the point of that? Then we both die. Then clearly there's no benefit, and we would just lose our life. So we cannot just jump without even understanding. So there needs to be an understanding. And also the Buddhist understanding is that beings have also karma, and karma needs to become purified. What needs to be purified is the afflictive emotions and their karmas. So through love and compassion, actually their karmas come, the negative karma comes to an end. And when we speak about, now in Buddhism, when we speak about protecting others, we are not just talking about protecting someone else's body in this life, but we are protecting them in all future lifetimes. And actually, we cannot really protect bodies. So in the Buddhist view, this compassion also is really founded on emptiness. So it has emptiness at its core. And that is also has to do with an understanding of karma. So of course, when we see that there is a being that suffers, for example, an animal that is being killed, of course there is compassion. There is suffering, we can see that, but also we understand that this is due to karma and that karma will come to an end. So if compassion has at its core emptiness, then it cannot tie you down or kind of keep you in bondage. And if there is no understanding of emptiness, then often when we see suffering, for example, you see a fish being killed or some other animals being butchered, then sometimes that feeling of suffering is just overwhelming and unbearable. Then we can't deal with our own suffering that has been created in our mind, and that's not helpful too. There was one quote by Longchen Rabcham that came from the, again, from the Treasury of Pith Instructions, and there he said that if there is grasping in the mind, then even compassion becomes a cause of bondage. So even that can become somehow harmful then. So if there is no grasping, the great compassion that we cultivate in Buddhism actually more looks in the long term. And actually, there's three lower realms. sometimes we can see them even as something like a hospital that is in a way also necessary. So for example, the hell realm is what cures hatred, or the hungry spirit realm is what cures stinginess, or the animal realm is what cures or purifies ignorance. And then, of course, knowing that, it is also important that we do not again in the future continue to engage in these actions, accumulating negative karma. But everyone has to purify their own karma. The Buddha had said karma has to ripen, has to be purified. And when you know that, then your mind will become more relaxed. Then even though you see suffering and you do feel compassion, it will not put you into a completely miserable state, because you also understand emptiness. So also, this is my own personal experience. Also, I have seen and experienced suffering, and this is really a way how I have dealt with it myself. So according to the Buddhist view, when it comes to protecting others, we cannot really protect them from karma that's already ripening. So sometimes we cannot save their bodies. And the body is actually nothing but matter. It's material matter. But what the Buddhist view does is the mind becomes protected through the aspiration of the bodhisattvas in future lives. Being's mind is protected. So if one doesn't know that, then people often come and say, please Rinpoche, help me, what can I do so he or she doesn't die, or somebody doesn't die, help us not to die. But this is something that cannot be done. There is no one in this world who doesn't have to die. Everyone has to die. And sometimes there have even been people who took the refuge vow, and then they died, and then they blamed the refuge vow. So it's not, there's no connection here actually. Because how the refuge vow protects you is not in this life, but in all future lifetimes. So the body will die, and when the body dies, if you have the refuge, the protection of the refuge, then what you will bring with you, even though you have lost the body, is the refuge of the three jewels, is bodhicitta, is love and compassion. But the Buddhist view really is that no one can really grant ultimate protection to material form, to the body.